I want to get back to this slide that we had looked at in the last class, and I want to make a couple of points. Let's try to reflect on how, what is behind the ability to be able to annotate things like the S&P 500 stock. So it's not that simple, right? It's not the same as annotating Microsoft or MSFT or PeopleSoft or Middle East. Right? There is also this other thing called Dow Jones Industrial Average. But the S&P, the Standard & Poor 500 Index that you see here, right? That seems... that's not easy to identify. It is actually a six graph, right? Six graphs there.
Yes.
And usually it is not easy, you know, easy to identify an entity of that kind. If you read the paper, did you get a sense as to why and how can you do this reasonably well? The paper I'm talking about is the semantic enhancement engineering.
Not exactly from the paper, but maybe a phrase matching.
But how do you identify this is a good phrase? How do you identify the phrase that is six, you know, word long? Chance?
I didn't get a question.
How do you identify such entities? Entities is like six entity, six word long entity. How do you identify that?
You should have some dictionary, some background.
Breaking down it further. Breaking it down further, like. Standard and poor are coming in the same coherence in a very nearby, could be a keyword for a phrase.
Use a tree algorithm. Then we have the first word as the root, and then we search for the next word. Is it the branch of the branch of the entity?
No.
Particularly domain specific, if we are talking something in the terms of financial domain, this is going to play a role.
That will play a role. But something else has happened. So if you remember, he said this system uses 9 classifier.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You remember that? What are the characteristics of this classifier? So now this is, we are going into relatively advanced things, and either you can probably understand this better if you have work in information retrieval and NLP and that kind of stuff. But basically, see, you have Bayesian classifiers and we have HMM classifiers.
Yes. And the sequences of words.
Very good. So HMM particularly, you know, even Markov model. Really looks at, looks at the statistics of frequency of word occurrences one after another. So it is relatively a better technique for information extraction of entities that are longer words.
I think actually should also the windows that one of the technique in natural language processing, understanding the windows, like 5 words neighborhood of 1 keyword.
The windows technique is a generic technique, but when you apply, typically you apply the windows, you know, of 3 words, 4 words, 5 words, 6 words. Most time people don't go that way, you know, because then there is so many 5 window terms that you see, which is actually not any entity. And how many, in this one, the only two entities altogether that are five or more. There's only one that is six or. It's a really exception. Most of them are two words. Middle East. Or one word. So, research in our group, Pramod, also did a good job in using CRF, conditional random field, for identifying such complex entities.
Yeah.
Right? So, there are certain classifiers that would work better for this or that. Now, taking, window of six words or taking even HMM can find the phrase, but you don't know whether that's an entity or not. So there, again, the knowledge base comes into picture. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And the knowledge base may have spelled standards and poor, where N, instead of ampersand here, it might have said N, A-N-D. So what you'll be doing is an approximate match. There are a number of text similarity functions available that will do reasonably well. Right? But this is a combination of appropriate classifiers. Bayesian classifiers work better on some other type of entities. For these longer terms, likely, I'm not 100% sure, but likely it is this kind of HMM. Combined with the ability to check in the knowledge base, then indeed there is a term of that kind. There's an entity called Tunnels Board Panel.
Suppose, in the same example, like the standard and poor finite index is there, right? If you also have an entity with like the standard and poor finite, also like finite is there, up to index is also there, like two entities are there.
In fact, standard and poor finite is an entity, and the index that standard for finite has come up with is standard and poor finite index.
Mm-hmm.
So both are entities. So there, the principle is the longest one is the more proper identification.
Right? But in our context, if it is only 500, like maybe index is kind of verb. In the phrase,
then it will only find some for finite entity, which is an organization or a company as the, and not the index as an entity.
Okay.
Right. So you see here that another meta comment I would like to make here is that things are fairly challenging. When you look at and often you have to combine multiple techniques to make the things work. Okay, so now let us look at the overall architecture of the system and some of the important principles it brings out, which I think are very relevant even today. So this architecture, this slide was drawn in somewhere in year 2000 and 2001, and in fact this. I've given talks on this in around 2001. This particular talk is actually a keynote in 2003. So, in this architecture, there are three overall components. And what's very important is that, it's important that you all understand the role of those three components. And it kind of goes back to this 1-2-3 of semantic web that I had discussed before. So number one is to create an ontology or a background knowledge base or reference of some sort. A knowledge graph or whatever you want to call it, right? So that is the first one here in this architecture. And there are different ways you can create this ontology. Ontologies, as I mentioned earlier, can be created by hand, manually. Domain experts come together and create the ontology. Ontologies can be created semi-automatically and they can be created automatically. Maybe if we have time, depends on how the course evolves, we will discuss what, you know, something more about Google's knowledge graph, for example. Right? And then now everybody is creating their own knowledge graphs. Right? So it's kind of a term that people use. And as I said, we have used the word term ontology or real world model in our world model in our times. We made one interesting observation that there are many high quality data sources to create an ontology. So an ontology typically has, and basically any database basically has two parts. The schema part, like data description language part, data description language, and the instance or extension part, the facts. Right? So your database actual data. The same thing in the ontology also at a representation level, you have a schema part and assertions or instances or extensions. These are all different words, they stand for the same thing. Right? If you go to AI, you'll see the word assertion. If you go to database, you'll see the word instance or extension. So it depends on, you know, which field you're coming from. Just the same as feature and attribute and property, they are kind of the same, right? So we made the observation that there are multiple high quality data sources, and what we have to do is to design the schema that is of interest to us. That is simply expressing what knowledge we want to have in our knowledge base. Of course, the knowledge in the world is vast. We have to decide what is interesting for our engine, for our application. And you saw in the patent application, we had these various things, sports and entertainment, and within entertainment, we had movies and sports, you had baseball and basketball, right? So that those are various, basically, domains for which we developed schemas. Have you designed schema? Are you aware of like ER model, entity representation model, that kind of thing? So this is something along that line. And then what we did was to find one, two or more sources to populate that ontology schema with instances or facts or assertions or instances, whatever you call it. So I'll give you one very good example, and this is something you should check for yourself. Suppose you want knowledge about the field of about music, right? So different albums you can buy, right? Britney Spears, and then this is the album, and these are the tracks in the album, and this is the recording label, and these are the artists. These are, so what all the things I went through, these are, there are schema elements, right? Artist is a schema, is a concept in your ontology or in your schema. Record label is a concept or entity type. Artist is an entity type or concept. And then you have instance. Britney Spears is a member of class artist, right? So we found, for example, you can look at the data source or a knowledge base, you might call, on Music Brains, MUSICBRAINZ. Just look for it. This Music Brains has over 600,000 artists. So practically anything, any artist you can think of is there. It has some large number, I forget now, maybe 60 albums with Christmas in the title. So, what happened, and it is created by a community of music lovers. The same way Wikipedia is created by editors. And the largest encyclopedia now is Wikipedia. Right? So, the same way music people, music aficionados have created Music Brains. So, what we have to do, of course, there are issues of licensing, whether data is public or not public. I won't go into those aspects, because if the data is not public, you have to license from them, you have to pay for the data. But let's assume, the point is that if I have to pay somebody to get the data, and the data is enough value for me, I'll pay. That's not a big deal. And if it is free, then I'll just crawl it and get it. Right? Just the way today, from Wikipedia, we create DBpedia, and then it is, you know, available for people to use. So he basically would, there was a source similar to Music Brains, or All Music in those days, I'm talking about that, but very similar in terms of coverage. And we got the data from there. For movie, you are probably aware of IMDb. IMDb data is not free, it has license constraints. But then there is Rotten Tomatoes, and there are number of other sources. Some of them are free and some of them are, you know, not free. Again, not going into the licensing and that technical, that business issue. Point is that the data is out there. Somebody has created it. So we simply tap into those kind of data sources. And the way it works is that in the ontology, the knowledge can get updated. So the idea here is that to keep the data up to date. The real world, you know, continues to evolve. One very interesting example in our case was that of, I'm talking about year 2000, right? So there was an election held in 2000. And in that election, I think Bill Clinton finished his second term, and then one of the second Bush got elected. And so we had a concept in the ontology, because we had ontology for political things, news and other things, right? So we had a concept called the Office of First Lady. Mm-hmm. And before the election, mm-hmm. it was Hillary Clinton, and then Mrs. Bush became the First Lady, mm-hmm. right? So now what happens? How do we do this? See, one of the issues that people had with regards to ontology is that, hey, if you create it manually, maintain manually, it's very expensive. Mm-hmm. So you need automated techniques to keep it up to date. So, I'm describing you in principle how it worked. The political data came from a source similar to CI Fact Book. There's a public source called CI Fact Book, which is all the lot of political and geographical knowledge. And so, we would write a crawler, or in this case, the word we used was knowledge extractor. Or in this case, KA stands for knowledge agent or knowledge extractor. But it's a software piece, right? That would go and visit a source of information and go through that and bring out the data in a structured form. Right? So it will do whatever it needs to do, parse the text there, do entity extraction, XYZ. One of the powerful things you can do is real expressions. To tokenize, to look for specific things. You know, if you understand the structure of the source, then you can use real expression. Right? Sorry, not even regular expressions. And you can pick up the content and say, that thing that appears there will go into this field in my schema, this schema element, as an instance. But the issues of relationship become more important. So there have, suppose the source has a table, then the table would be mapped into possibly a triple. A row would be mapped into a triple. Because our model was graph model, like RDF. So you have subject, predicate, object. So it may be a relational database kind of stuff. We will explicitly input to make a relationship from the implicit relationship. Because we know the semantics. Right? So the agent is adding additional semantics by explicitly naming the link. So we would have extractor that would have gone in 1999, you know, April or June, where Hillary Clinton was found. Office of First Lady is occupied by Hillary Clinton. And then agent goes back again. So we had an infrastructure where we would be able to invoke the agent at the schedule we wanted. So let's say that we look at every month or every 3 months or something, because we think that this thing will change so often. We don't want to do it all the time because it's too much competing resources and too much communication wasted. So this agent would have gone then in, after November 6th election, but actually officially the president takes office on the 20th of January. So 20th of January 2001, all the database would have changed actually. And our agent going after that would have picked up Mrs. Bush. Now the software agent says, I found this fact and checks again the facts that are in the ontology. And this is now, they are not the same. So there are a number of things that you have to do. Again, this depends on how you implement it. One would be to throw an exception. And the human will say what it is and say, oh, the new information is correct, remove the old information. Other would be that you have a constraint in your ontology saying that there will be only one person in the office of White House, First Lady of the United States. And that the latest information is the most accurate. Then what you'll do, you'll deprecate, saying that now the relationships would be timed. So there will be time to say, I found this fact on this date. And then it'll keep that data, but I'll input one more thing saying, on a later date, I found this fact. And then your software agent can use either of them. Now look at the challenges involved here. Very interesting, think about it. Suppose your search query was looking for information that was before the election. Then you should be using for, because I'll show you later on, you will be doing search. Right? News search. The news item has a date. If the date is before, it matches with the previous fact, then that is the one you could use. Because you come across Hillary Clinton, then you want to understand who is Hillary Clinton. I have this entity, Hillary Clinton, right? You say, who is Hillary Clinton? Well, if you know the date and the knowledge base says Hillary Clinton is the first lady, because the article is written before the January 20th of 2001, then you can say it is first lady. But after that, she's not the first lady. Right? So these are very challenging issues. I don't think that any search engine currently takes care of that issue. They have knowledge bases, but this kind of keeping the time and all is extremely hard. I'd be surprised if they do it. I'm sure they know of the challenge and maybe they are working on it, maybe they are doing some of it, I don't know. You guys need to go to Google search, they claim to a 70 search, try and see if they can understand that, if they can give that. Do they only know the last information or last piece of knowledge? Right? That Michelle Obama is the first lady? Or they also know the fact that at one point after, before Michelle Obama, this was first lady at this time. Think about it. Right? So, these things can be pretty complicated. There are some reasons I won't discuss in much more detail as to why we could do that and why it will still be very hard to do at such a large scale as Google search. Now let's look at the next part. Oops. The second part is the content. And the interesting thing is that content can be many different forms. Again, you have always the choice of the breadth versus depth and where do you fall. In our case, we wanted to explicitly understand different kinds of content. So you can see a whole bunch of content types, right? Databases, XML feed, websites, emails, reports, documents. We would be able to deal with unstructured, semi-structured, and structured data in our search engine. So our search engine is not simply meant for HTML data. It was meant for heterogeneous kind of documents. Right? So it was, again, let's move up. And now, the same way that there were knowledge agents that were extracting knowledge, we have now content agents. They're not exactly the same, and I'll explain you how they are different. But in principle, they again go to the data and do something with that. In this case, extract metadata and index it. But how do you do that well? With that previous picture I showed you, standard poor 500 or things, there are a lot of challenges are there, and I'm going to explain to you a few of them. So the content agent simply go get new data that should be made searchable, semantically searchable, browsable, whatever else we need. Now the interesting thing was, we wanted to make our search engine fresh. We are very in those days we also wanted to support what these days we call velocity, change in the data. So here's an interesting thing, things that happens. Suppose you look at a web page, let's say news story web page like CNN. Then the page changes several times in a day. It's not the same. So what if I had looked at the web page, found an item, a news item on a page, index it and say this is the item there, go to this page to find that, I search for it and my search engine says go there, but now that it is moved. Right? And the new item is there, how do you deal with that? Challenging, right? Again, it can take long time to discuss all the things that you will do for that, but let me discuss a couple of things. So, in this what we know, again I'm talking about year 2000-2001, right? So things, web was a little different. In fact, quite different those days. And in those days, we found out, so, you know, sites like CNN, they were constructed using, website creation tools like Cold Fusion in those days. So there were a variety of, tools that were available so that you don't have to all type, HTML, you can, compose it in a more interestingly, graphical environment. And we found through our observation that the CNN website was updated 3 times a day. And it won't be exactly precisely that second or thing, but because there's still human involved in those days of updating websites. So the, somebody will push out an update on the web page and they will do it 3 days, but sometime in their 5 days, earlier or later. So we basically identified the times. We had an infrastructure where our agents would go. And agents, when they go, they will tell us, is there a new information on that website or is the information the same as before? So you have to create a delta in the content. Okay? So once we figure out that CNN is updated 3 times, we'll run our schedule, our content extractor for CNN to run, let's say, 1 hour after the schedule update time. So we may be 1 hour, out of date, but not more than that, right? Or something along that line. And when we run, if there is a content has not changed, we'll retry it again in short time until it has changed, because we know it does change often. And so that is one way we deal with this thing. Now, because of this, what happened is in 1999, when I was trying to raise money for my company, I went to the venture capital fund and said, I want to build this, so-called semantic search engine. I said, what the heck is that? It's Google, and Google is already there. Okay? And AltaVista, so how are you better? So I took the latest story that had broken. That day's story. And my content extractor would have gone to the websites like CNN and would find that story. I searched exactly the same query on my search engine and Google. Google could not find it in those days. Because they are trying to index so many pages and they could not run their crawler that often. So the news kind of, the velocity, content with velocity, content that was changing often, they couldn't do that well. Well, my site was able to do that well because I had this dynamic aspects and velocity support aspect of it. In addition, I had semantic aspect, which I'll show you in the next few slides. Right? Okay. Now this content extractor goes there and basically finds the content. It does less of a effort. Now the differences. Knowledge extractors have to be run very infrequently, relatively speaking, compared to Container Center. So let's take an example that I'm talking about NFL football, National Football League, professional in football. And I have knowledge base of all the teams and all the team rosters and all that stuff, right? How often that changes? Usually, only once in a season. So after there's this player recruited and all, right? What is that called?
Auction. Player auction.
Player auction. There's another term also that where.
Draft.
Beginning. Draft. Yeah. Player draft.
Okay.
So player, that after draft day, some team people acquire thing and then they announce the team. This is this. And then sometimes occasionally somebody is injured and he new person replaces as a quarterback or whatever, that happens occasionally. But by and large it only changes once a season. Now I don't have to run this extractor too often, maybe a couple of times a year. The music changes more often, new things. So there these extractors are not simple extractors just going to one site, one page. They understand the site structure. So they would know which part of the site puts the latest information, or where do I get to find the delta information, and pull up just the delta information, put it back. They don't have to, because if I have 100,000 entities there, triple worth of things, and I try to get each of the pages and extract from that, and that's very time consuming. Instead, we will look for the sophisticated extractor. They will know where you can find delta information and put the things there. But compared to those knowledge extractors that we run few times a year, or once a month, or some such thing, or once a week, content extractor will typically run once a day, or several times a day, or much more frequently, depending upon the content. Again, some sites will be static, and some new site particularly would be dynamic. We particularly specialize towards more dynamic content. And so again, there are challenges. If I want to tune my search engines to deal with breadth and do the Google's job, there's one thing. If I want to do something on high value, more frequently change job, I have to do something else. And then once I get the information, then I have to understand what it is. And for that, then we had this so-called semantic enhancement, which is exactly that paper that I pointed to and showed you last time. And there are two major components there. What are those? First is
word model and knowledge extraction.
Yeah, in this case, content extraction, metadata extraction. But it's not particularly word model itself. Word model is there, but what we do here is using this automatic classification. Why do we have that? The reason we have that is that suppose there is John Smith. Well, there are two John Smiths, right? So for disambiguation, I want to understand whether this is sport content or business content. Automatic classifier will do that for me. So it will define the scope of interpretation. Another word for that is context. It will decide what context? Context with respect to my ontology or world model. I had all these ontologies, sub-ontologies in there, right? I have ontologies for sports, and within the sports I have baseball and football and basketball. So I would like to go to the lowest level in my ontology in terms of the sub-ontology, subdomain, lowest, most the subdomain, which is what this the taxonomy. For automatic classification is exactly the same as the taxonomy of my domains in my ontology. And the classification will classify me to the leaf node. Then that means that the knowledge corresponding to the leaf node is the knowledge base I want to use for my entity extraction and for enhancing the entities. Any question?
So, suppose let us consider some dynamic sites. We are extracting data from dynamic sites.
So how usually we'll be scheduling the runs? I mean, how we'll be extracting data?
The schedule, as I said, we will know through experience how often the website changes. Remember, I extract and tell you when I run whether the site changes or not, has changed or not.
So instead of that, can't we have an interface between content sources and content agents, which will be grabbing? I mean, such that if some data is changed on a particular database,
what kind of interface you have? Somebody's third party's website. Why would they in those again? There isn't anything that it's not their responsibility to tell me that they have changed anything. I'm a search engine. I need to crawl. I need to access that.
That's what. If you have an interface, which will be scheduled like for every 10 minutes or something is changed.
Right. If you have
instead of extractors going and checking everything data.
Yeah. So I think you bring up a good point. So I'll clarify that. So the sources right, they were of two broad kind from the perspective of our distributed computing infrastructure. They were either pull content, meaning they were HTML websites and we had to just go and crawl it.
Mm-hmm.
Or they were push contents. So we had some data sources with news aggregator sites,
mm-hmm.
where they would aggregate content from many sources, but then they will push it to the subscriber.
Mm-hmm.
In that case, they will send the content to us. We don't have to go and crawl it. We don't have to ask them, hey, is there a new content or not? In that case, when they send us content, then we run our content extract on them.
They are like RSS feeds and all that.
Hmm?
RSS feeds.
Right. And there are more sophisticated things than that. So, I'll talk to you about Prism and NewsML and other kind of interfaces that are there. And there is there's also subscriber network. So, there is an infrastructure where essentially, there will be basically a pipe on which they will continue to send new content continuously, and then you put in your server as soon as that content comes in, and then as soon as new content comes in, you run your extractor. So that will be for push content. For pull content, where you don't have any relationship with their site, you just have to go to their site to see whether something is there or not.
Yeah, we have to do manually.
Right, through the crawler, periodic
scheduling or something.
Right. Just like Google bots. Or being bought. Right? They all come and visit your website and see if things are changed, right? And pick up.
And in some sites like in htaccess, they give, right, like alone, none. If they give such things, then even if a crawler goes there, it will return, like the site doesn't allow for us to crawl it.
Yeah, there's robot.txt, for example. And you have to worry about those things also, yes.
Yeah.
But yeah, again, that's a totally other set of discussions because there was a time where some news site says, no, we don't want to be indexed.
Yeah.
Then they found out that if those sites are making money through advertisement, they are losing out. At the end of the day, suppose there's a news.google.com, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you say, okay, I don't want my news to be on news.google.com, right? Fine. So that's okay. You have copyright and content, you can't index it, right? Okay. But then what happens? Search engines or aggregator sites like that won't send customers there.
Yeah.
At the end of the day,
yeah.
If you're news, .google.com, when you click, you actually go to the Google website, right?
Yes.
Unless they have a relationship to show snippet.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things there. I have some knowledge of that and I can go into that, but that's not very important because it's more of a business issue than a technology issue. But I think at the end of the day, most of the sites decide it's good to be indexed and get traffic from the search engines and directories and whatever. So that's how it works.
So in terms of what you said about automatic classification, is it the same method that you are using in the semantic content for the web that we have, like the resolving metadata extraction ambiguity? Like you are doing it in two different phases, a classification-based method and knowledge-based method.
So the automatic classify itself has this in the one obviously over the years we even change the software, just like Google changes the software for 100 times a year or more. In the implementation that is described in the semantic enhancement engine paper, it shows 9 classifiers.
Yes.
I think three Bayesian, three HMM, and in knowledge base, something like that. So that is what that box of automatic classification is. And then there is this entity extraction and the enhancement, which I will show you how this works in the next few slides.
Dr. Shah, I would like to add an example from Selvam's talk.
Uh-huh.
And it's a very interesting application.
Mm.
So Amazon do their dynamic pricing with the help of content agent. So they go and crawl all over the web through their, all their competitor and everything. And Dr. Shah's student, Selvam was over there, and he has taken care of that work. Now he's a group on CTO of Asia Pacific. So he was giving a talk, and he has mentioned it by the crawlers. We got to know like which competitor is updating their price when, and with the help of that, they were doing the dynamic pricing, and that is now in all the e-commerce website, and they were kind of very first to do that.
Yeah. So this is Selvam.
But I think problem occurs when all the e-commerce follow the same. Like one will be waiting for the other to update.
They are the first, they are doing might be the best algorithm. Who knows? Now it's open, now everybody wants to get the piece of the pie, but who did it first? They'll have the leverage.
Yeah.
This is an idea. You come up with it,
yes,
and you grab the market.
Right. So, Selvam, after he did the master's with me, he got hired by a company that got acquired by Amazon. This was actually a startup that they got acquired. But anyway. That general kind of stuff, in different forms survives even today, right? That's a very interesting point. Thanks. Okay. So, once we have then all the metadata, I'll show you what kind of metadata looks like. Then we have so-called a server, a query server, which does the computation, the item 1, 2, 3, third. I have the metadata, now I can do various things, and those could be many things. So it will be, by the way, there are other ways to get metadata also. And then here, the application could be all that in my patent, says browsing, searching, advertisement, all those things will be done off that server, right? Now, let's look at, this is an example of, this is a description of ontology, right? We had, most of the time I'm talking about this, this technology is in search engine. We also had the same platform adapted for enterprise uses. Okay. So in that case, the ontology is very different. Okay. So we had ontologies that had that varied from few classes to tens of classes, and relationships and number of entities very, very extensively. And you can see some of the things here, right? But the point here is this is very interesting, that with the few person weeks afford, we could create those ontologies. So this is an example of our ontology, which is very simple, but it has very large number of instances. This was ontology for one of the very large Europe-based music label. Right? And another case, the ontology, this intermediate ontology, which is again showing you about what is in the ontology. Then there are some technical challenges that are faced here. Inconsistent field values, unfilled values, field values appearing to mean the same but are different, non-normalized data, uppercase versus lowercase, scoring. There are a lot of other challenges that go on into doing the things. Also, we have this main memory system to do the fast processing and so on and so forth. Because a lot of these involve computations. The traditional IO-centric system did not scale well for us. We have to create actually main memory system. And we, all of you, there's material available for you to look at it in detail if you're interested. And then it shows you you know, practical example of what it takes to actually build some of these things. Now, here is the process of how the ontology is used. So we have these kind of tools. So first we will create the ontology model or description or schema. So this is just a graphical tool that allows you, just like you can think of protege kind of thing. Mm. And you can see you have these classes and you are defining all the details, and here are you giving more details. Like for example, you can only have single value for the first office of first lady. And should you keep the old value or not? All those details are just right here. Right? So comprehensive schema design with the rules or constraints. That was then used to create automatically with little or no programming this software agent. We know what you want. And we know the format of the source. So it requires two information. You know what you want, and you know how the information is available right now. That has to be transformed into the form that you want. So sometimes a particular class value may come from two different sources. For example, I have a class stock traded on all public stocks, or all stocks that are traded on US stock markets. And in this case, there are three public stock market exchanges: NASDAQ, 9X, and MX. And each of them have their own listing. And in fact, listing changes every day. Stocks get delisted every day. So here, for NASDAQ, crawler would have to run every day. Extractor, NASDAQ noise extractor would have to run every day. But it will only return. It will not return all the stocks. It will only return the data. Because the new listing and delisting will be separately listed. Right. So we'll just look at that. And we'll send the information back here. But same way, I have to do with this thing, and then aggregate of that would be thing. So in this case, one class was populated from three different sources. Right? And this is automatic aggregation of knowledge. So this extractor will be scheduled to run at different rate with different sources. And the data will be coming here, all those things, dirty data, many things have to be done. It's not that simple. And then it will come, it will put the data into the ontology. And then you query the ontology for the other purpose. So it kind of stores in detail, right? So, and all these details, the slides are there. So you create entity class, organize them in a taxonomy person, business person, analysis, stock analysis. Establish any number of meaningful named relations between entity classes. Entity analyst works for a company. Stock analyst tracks sector. Business person owns shares in the company. Set any number of attributes of an entity person, address, birth date, stock analysis ID, whatever those things are. Right? In here, configure parameters. Or attribute pertaining to indexing, lexical analysis, interface. Also, existing industry-specific taxonomy like MESH, medical, can be reused or imported into the ontology. We are talking about year 2000. Here, create and configure knowledge agents to populate the ontology. So, identify any number of trusted knowledge sources relevant to customers' domain from which to extract the knowledge. Then sources can be internal, external, secure, proprietary, public sources, meaning license. Manually configure one time the knowledge agent for a source by configuring which relevant sections to crawl, what knowledge to extract, what predefined intervals to extract knowledge at. A knowledge agent will automatically run at the configured time intervals and extract entities and relationships from the sources to give the ontology up to date. These are various interface to this specific kind of stuff to create this agent, schedule it, all the stuff. So that's why you do not need programmer to actually create these agents. Only thing we have to teach them is regular expressions. And understanding of how site structuring works, and site map and those kind of stuff. Now, the third is automatic aggregation of knowledge. So, automatic, so again, that happens at three different times, supplemented by easy to use monitoring tools. So, the tools will tell you when you run an extractor, what if the site structure has changed? Then there will be some manual changes to the ontology, the crop agent kind of stuff, right? Knowledge agents extract and organize their own knowledge into the ontology based on ontology model. Tools for disambiguation and cleaning. This is very. These are the more important hard things to do. And ontology is constantly growing and kept up to date. Give you an example. See, like, here you have TCUS, so here's an ontology, industry, TCUS symbol, Cisco system has channel partners, e-business solutions, competition, sector, executives, works for, you see relationship, right? And then there is, other things like incremental indexing, distributed indexing, knowledge APIs provide a Java, JSP, or STP based interface to querying those things. So that's what at that time. So here is an example of an ontology that we created, which had rather complex schema, and this had this is for anti-money laundering application in financial industry. So in this particular case, ontology schema had 50 entity classes, 100 attribute types, and 60 relationship types. Right, a decent size. And here is just kind of a schema snapshot, only partial schema. For that. So here an example, at one point of time, we had this assertional component about 1.5 million entities, attribution relationship. And it was, we got that knowledge from four licensed or public sources of knowledge. Dun & Bradstreet, Corporate 192, Company Houses and Hoovers. And it took less than a week to design the schema. Sometimes you keep on extending. And population took only a few days. So this, the point I try to show you is that ontology or knowledge base plays such an important role, and that it was not that expensive to do that. So it is in this context you need to see that blog, with Peter Norvig's post and my post to understand. This is what will help you understand where I'm coming from.
If I try to just oppose these technologies to tweet this one, I can compare the knowledge content agent to the campaign extractor. While the idea of semantic filtering, what you were talking about, it would be something like build this kind of knowledge base behind and help me to search on the data according to this knowledge base. So I was always thinking that semantic filtering is something that in the same input from the input. As the data, but it's not. It's like on another dimension. It's when data are already there, and I can actually query them thanks to this knowledge that is semantically part of the data. Is it right?
There are some high level similarities because, again, the same general thought process drives it, right? It's very interesting. Once your brain starts wired something, you keep on trying to do the same way. But there are some differences, not exactly the same. Let's talk that offline a bit more because there's a lot more to cover and we'll go off track in discussing that. So, and here are some of the technical challenges that we face ambiguity resolution at entity execution, extraction level, modeling the ontology to capture adequate details of the domain for application, and so on and so forth. Adding entities on the fly for that, entities, like new knowledge can come, right? So here is the very fundamental principle of how what do you do, right, with the data on the web, right? So your data of many different kinds. One of the important things is again our source, one of the first search engines for audio video content also, not just text. Okay? So most of the search engines initially were for text, and there were some image data, but the image search were very simplistic. Now they have become very sophisticated, by the way. It's impressive what work that has gone on in image search, and they do some amazing things now. And video search also, in search. But basically, the principle is the following. You have, you know, various content. You can have push or pull, right? And you can have proprietary, deep web, open source, whatever that you have. At the end of the day, you write these extractors or something that processes the data, and from that you get the metadata, right? Or semantic annotations, what you call. So let's see how that works. I'll give you some examples. Again, this technology kept on changing over the period of time, but so this is a snapshot. So in this case, what happened is that there is this web page. You can see the web page on the left side. And then what we did was, we did first automatic categorization. You saw that, you know, we had the automatic classification, same thing. And it said that in this case, that page is, this is the result of automatic classification. So it says, I think it is baseball. Now what happens is that if it is baseball, I'm interested in the elements that are defined in the baseball schema, ontology schema. Oh, it's a sports person, and the location, and team name, and things of that nature. If it is the type of metadata I'm interested in to extract from a baseball, is different than the football, is different than business. This is a very advanced thing that we used to do that even today's search engine don't do. Today's search engine don't extract different types of metadata for different sources. So this is the you know, fundamental to the semantic thing. If you ask yourself as a human, if I'm going to read a content, a news story or, you know, news article about a baseball game, very likely my eyes are going to fall on the things that are baseball centric. There may be all kind of words there. There may be an advertisement on the side. My brain is going to focus on baseball. And so the I can extract things here which has nothing to do with baseball. It's a Wednesday morning. Well, maybe it was not important for me. I mean, search engine can always index Wednesday. But what is the chance I'm so interested in Wednesday per se? Maybe I'm interested in the date. Negotiate with. Well, I'm not interested in negotiate, for example, in this page. It's possible. Actually, I don't see the whole thing. I'll show you some other things. But there are a lot of things here that are, you know, so it's very likely that at least these things are of interest to you. And the system not only gets this guy, Andy Ashby, it says he is a sports person in baseball. So, and so it just shows you part. So this is semantic metadata in that sense.
So, do you think that, for example, Google is not doing the categorization? For example, some of the results will put like the categories of each result that they have on the search.
So
do you think that they are not doing it for the computational cost or what?
To my knowledge, Google did not do that until 2012.
Okay.
Then, what is happening now? So Google did, for example, as I said, this evolution. Earlier, at the time that we have this, Google did not do that at all, nowhere close to that. They have some other advantages over us, and you know, it's not like they are, you know, they are very smart people, of course. But then, the basic search engine, the information retrieval thing, crawling and looking at all the text, and then doing the page rank to say which of those pages on which this word appears is more important in the ranking. Those things Google did well. Then eventually Google started to pay attention to basic types of very core type of entities like people, location, organization. But it was not overtly available in the result per se. It's just that it would understand when you type in the name of a person. Because it found out that a lot of people were searching by the name of a person or name of a location. So they wanted to specialize for those things and not just treat them as keyword, treat them as entities. So they started doing a very, very basic entity type evolution. Then they started to download and start using the, you remember in my slide in that also, this also, as I mentioned, Mesh.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, they also started to get some of those knowledge bases. But they did not create a large schema, an ontology like the one we had. Clearly, they did not, because there, in 2005, Peter Norvig in his blog said that they don't believe in ontology at all. And in fact, no knowledge structure they believe in. They believe only in machine learning and bottom-up. So all these things I'm talking about entities was again after that. And then, it's kind of late 2000s. And then, you know, they saw, you remember in one of my early slides, PowerSet was acquired by Microsoft. Siri was acquired by Apple. So they started seeing the value of knowledge base or ontology. And Google saw an opportunity to pick in a good size knowledge base, general knowledge base called Freebase, which I think at, by the time they acquired at 5 million entities. Not that large, really. But you know, it was very limited. So because of manual creation, it was high quality. So it became their bootstrapping. It becomes their seed set of concepts and relationship and schema that they obviously had some schema, right? Just like DBBD has a schema. So it created, you know, gave them that base. Then they started to, and we'll discuss a bit later on, to continue to add semi-automatic means and actually integrate multiple things. Just like I mentioned, you know, in my thing that we got data knowledge from many sources, they started doing that. And now they have come up with a lot more automated way to extract new facts from the web. So there have been a number of very popular NLP kind of projects. One of the very well-known projects is called NLL, never-ending learning system from CMU as an example. And CMU has a dedicated department on, you know, doing this kind of stuff. So in fact, my last keynote was at IEEE Big Data. And let me in fact show you what it is. I'm forgetting it, but this is 2015, right? So if you look at here, Tom Mitchell, right? So in fact, I gave a keynote here, and then Joseph Hellestein gave a keynote from this. But here is the keynote by Tom Mitchell. So he he talked about this never-ending language learning system, right?
Yeah.
And this one is a system that actually continuously runs, goes to new web pages, and brings out facts, tuple. And so these have been running, you know, this project has been running for several years. And Google has hired a lot of engineers from, in fact, from this specific group. And there's another very interesting project of similar kind from University of Washington. They have a very good system called Yale. Similarly, very good work was done by a colleague of mine, a good friend of mine at Saarbrücken, at the they have national laboratory there, and Gerhard Weikam and his student Fabian Suchanek, and then another set of very good system is at use of Massachusetts Amherst. So there are several major machine learning kind of centric projects, most of them towards the second half of the last decade, like 2005 onwards kind of thing. Then they started to basically extract facts from the web. So it is this kind of technologies that now Google has incorporated that have then made the transformation from Google's knowledge graph to what they call Google Knowledge Vault. And Google's philosophy always has to be you know, to do things on large scale and hence automatically. So while they saw enough value in the freebase, then they said, well, we can't, you know, we don't want to keep on doing it manually. So they started to do more automated, you know, techniques. Right? Of course, I don't know, they're not published everything, so I don't know everything that they do, but there are some of these my educated guesses. And you can see the people that have gone there. And but at the same time, Google also acquired a number of semantic web people. And, you know, just like, I don't know whether Ramnath Guha will call him semantic web person, but, you know, he really knows core of, you know, web, and he knows semantics. And as an inventor, you know, as a developer of MCF, which predates RDF, he clearly understands certain aspects of semantics very well. And he understands this thing. And he and I talked not too long ago. We were both giving again, I don't know, we were both at a very conference where I think we were both giving talks or something, talking outside, I think. And he talked about doing some very interesting thing of at least K, having many large number of assertions kind of stuff. And then he was telling me how he found some of the semantic web work to be useless, in that those who, you know, really focused on OWL work and stuff, for them at the large scale in Google, that didn't work kind of thing. So, but he did, so it's clearly, they all believe in graph, the power of graph, and the relationship as first class object, as I mentioned in my 2002 talk, right? Now, if you look at another content, now in this case, so you can see this was a web page. Here is another source. Now, this happens to be a BBC News page. Right? And you have to do a lot of things so that you don't pick up this kind of stuff, right? I mean, you have to throw this kind of stuff, right? And you get somehow these things. So these are a lot of challenges. Once you get these things, you see, this shows you the schema we have for the news item. So you can see ID of something. By the way, needs attention, check. Every search engine has people, humans, looking out for the quality. I met, there used to be another big search engine. What is it called? The name skips my mind. I think now it is not doing too well. Oh, the question, the one that is special on question answering.
Ask.
Exactly. So the guy waiting there, you know, you also found professor, and I know him very well. He told me, you know, in confidence, not the public, saying, we have 250 people looking after the quality of data and index. And they said we have to sweep, particularly things like pornographic data and scamming thing and all those kind of stuff, right? And that's very hard. We were talking about last class, rumor and you know, this kind of thing, sarcasm, which I hard to manage. Similarly, there are these other things underbelly of search engine that's just hard to manage and still require humans. So then your keywords, you know, source, the title, Kostunica, whatever, pushes for war crime law. News type, a video. There's a video on the thing. Surrogate, which is exactly, you know, surrogate is the picture that, you know, image that stands for the video. You click on that, is resulting video. URL. This URL can be embedded URL. In fact, once we have to go 7 level deep to actually find the real, you know, you know, video clip. Then this is description, which is part of this. Clip length, parent URL, I don't know what, you know, location. Now, here's the example. So, what happened here is that here, these contents only mention Belgrade. Remember, this is before the division of Yugoslavia. And our knowledge base, we have knowledge base that says, you know, every country with major towns, cities, and what is the capital, and all kinds of knowledge, geographical knowledge is there. So we, even though this only says Belgrade, we extended that to Yugoslavia, Europe. So, so somebody wants to get news for Yugoslavia, I can give you that. A traditional search engine of those times could not do that. Any search engine of those times, other search engines could not do it because they could only find text. Belgrade, there's no text Yugoslavia on this page, so how would they know? That is semantics, that's knowledge. So this is called semantic enhancement. Or in this case, this thing only mentions Milosevic. And it says President Milosevic. Then I will replace that, or I will say it also not only President Milosevic, I'll say Slobodan Milosevic, who was the president at that time. Right? And you know, so you get generally the idea, right? That this is concept of semantic enhancement. So this kind of describes, you know, so you take the in the server, you create this content and you do the classification, and then you look at the knowledge base, and then you do the enhancement of the knowledge base, and then you know you embed the metadata within the data itself, and then index the whole stuff with different priority on semantic metadata getting higher priority than any text like that. Here are some interesting problems. Ambiguity. So, semantics, I'll make one very fundamental observation. One of the fundamental things about semantics is simply to decide how are two things related. Relationship is the first, you know, important relationship is extremely high. But then the corollary of that is to say how are two things related? Are the two things exactly the same? If not, how same? Or in what way they are related? In what context they are related? This is the fundamental issue about semantics. Okay? So, here are the things that means ambiguity. Are they same or different? Not clear, right? If I use the word Springfield, which is a you know city, that's Springfield, Ohio. Well, there are 13 Springfield in the United States. And if I say Athens, Ohio, well, there's Athens, Georgia, and there's Athens, Greece. Which one do you mean? You ask for Athens, news about Athens, and the person means news about Athens, Greece, and you give them content of Athens, Ohio, he's not going to be happy. That's where the semantics has to come in. Right? So, you have to find entity candidates in the document, the names and synonyms, common variations, all those things you have to do, right? There's a lot more to this here. I won't go into the details here. But a general idea here is that you have a lot of things related to a concept which helps you understand it is this concept or that concept by not only looking at the names, the syntax, but the relationship they participate in. So, overcoming some of the issues in resolving entity, here you can see resolution of issues over terminology. Benefit number is an alias of semantics SSN, right? Social security number. Resolution over identity is executive, Larry Levy, an existing entity or a new entity. Enabling decisions made over trust versus existing data. Which source did the data originate from? Should I trust that? Right? What is the validating an inferencing constraint or cardinality? Like President of India said, there's only one, can't have multiple. Right? So you see that Hillary Clinton example? Managing temporal aspects of a domain, expression of entities, right? Hillary Clinton is no longer the first lady of the United States, but was until, and this case, by the way, is not, in real world, it is actually. January 20, I mentioned to you, right? But I actually found out only on May 3rd. So that's all I know, right? Because that's when you know, I found the new knowledge. Providing audit capability. How did I know that indeed this is a terrorist? How do you where did that information come from, right? Ontological relationship, there are various other things. Now here's a very simple and interesting example. Have you ever been to Athens? How about Japan? So you have Athens And I have all these Athens, now your terms like Athens in Japan, what do they mean? In my ontology, I have all of these. Athens, Greece, Europe. Athens, Georgia, United States, North America. Athens, Ohio. Athens, Tennessee. And I have Japan in Asia. Now, if all of these, score equally, then I can't disambiguate. But when I have this, have you ever been to Athens or anywhere else in Georgia? Now you can see. Right? I have more thing, Georgia to work with. Now I can say what and which Athens I'm talking about. And so I could do this. And here you see knowledge-based statistical linguistic techniques. Linguistic, those window thing is linguistic. Finding a phrase is linguistic. Then you look for entity using combinational statistical, those classifiers and knowledge base. Then we would do automatic semantic enhancement. So you see here Phillips Petroleum Shell. And then we would add to that various things, knowledge there, here. So for example, what you started here got expanded to all these different things. For example, we would say value-added relevant meta tag added by semantics to existing context tag. Context is the is a news aggregator that will push the content. Okay. In the time when we worked with context, they had 95 different sources of news content. And they will push it to us. CN we have to pull. There are all these things that came from our knowledge base. So you give me one or two things, I disambiguate it, and then I take all the relevant information and add to this. Some distributed computation, load balancer, implementation stuff and all that, because we had to have our own data center and all the stuff. So now you see this application, you're seeing this video anywhere where I search for this. This is a very first thing. And we call it video anywhere. I talked about this earlier already. Look at this example. So you look for Jamal Anderson. And you see this is search, for football. You can choose whatever it is. By the way, there's also keyword. Which is, if you don't do anything, you don't have to use this. You can use this just like a Google search engine or single thing. And then the system will do the best you can. But when you do that, you get the results that are focused on, Jamal Anderson. And here, what happens is that it knows that you are interested in Jamal Anderson, so it will only give you Jamal Anderson. But then there will be do syntactic search like Mike Anderson. It's not Jamal Anderson, so it will say closely match, but not exact match. So our system did, a stratified thing with exact match, closely match, and possible match. Here, you are searching for you search by either, you search by, let's say, Jamal Anderson. You search by Atlanta Falcon. And let's say the news source doesn't mention Atlanta Falcon at all. But because we know that Jamal Anderson plays for Atlanta Falcon, we had put that as team, Atlanta Falcon. So you found the content for Atlanta Falcon, even though the news text only says Jamal Anderson. So you see the value of semantic enhancement. This is a project for some company. What time is it?
3:30.
Huh? 3:30. Wow, time flies. Well, then I think we will stop here. Can you stop this?